Thank you. Oh, yeah.
I think. Yeah.
Networking, I think you hit this one here. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation to speak at this forum. And I wanted to thank the organizers because it was very well organized. I really enjoyed it. This program was great. So I'm going to talk about the Near Earth Asteroid Scout mission that Victoria Friedenson introduced a couple of days ago. And these are key participants to this presentation. And this involves, of course, the NSCout engineering team. I did not present all the names, but there are a bunch of people, and especially a lot of early career people involved in this mission. It's a very exciting mission. So for me, it's the third mission I'm involved in that deals with CubeSats. So I love them. One of the first one is the Interplanetary Nanospacecraft Pathfinder in a Relevant Environment, which is a tech demonstration mission that is developed by JPL in collaboration with a number of universities, and whose goal is to demonstrate telecommunication and navigation with CubeSats. The other project I'm involved in is the Hedgehog. It's a hybrid rover. But we really like to call it the Hedgehog, which is started as a NIAC project and has got further funding for development under the Center for Innovative Funds. And it's going to fly on a parabolic flight. I think it's next spring. It's going to be very exciting if we get to TRL-5. And that's a hopper. So it's especially designed for bodies in from, you know, Itokawa to about Phobos. So now I'm focusing on NSCout. Here is the outline. I will introduce NSCout, present the target for NSCout, which is not that one. And then a little bit about the science definition and on the science implementation. So first introduction. So it's the chart that Victoria showed on Monday. So briefly, there were three CubeSat missions that were selected by the Advanced Exploration System back in September, and those goals are to retire, to develop CubeSat concepts that would retire strategic knowledge gaps. And one is the Lunar Flashlight mission that Barbara Cohen is going to describe, to present afterwards. One is the BioSentinel mission developed by ARC and GSC, and there is NSCout. So right now, our projects are in pre-formulation. We had a review of the science plan, and it went very well for NSCout. It was very, I think the reviewers were interested, and they were very excited about the technological aspect of the mission, which is a bit very novel. And we will have a mission concept review slash systems requirement review in August. And after that, we'll have a design review next year. So in a nutshell, why NSCout? So we want to go to a candidate near-Earth asteroid and address key strategic knowledge gaps that I'm going to detail. And more generally, the idea is to demonstrate low-cost reconnaissance capability for the human, for the interest of the human exploration program. It leverages a number of technologies, the solar sail development expertise that Marshall had with the nanosail mission. The CubeSat development and standard that comes from the INSPIRE mission over CubeSat mission that JPL is involved in, as well as, of course, the university and industry experience. The idea, I mean, one key aspect of this program is to leverage synergies between the three CubeSat missions in order to decrease costs. And specifically to NSCout, what we want to do is obtain the NEA, the asteroid volume, spectral class, the spin properties, ephemeris, and address also, I mean, obtain observations that help us address key physical and Regolis questions. So we'll have a coverage at least of the full surface at 50 centimeters per pixel, and at least, you know, one hemisphere at a resolution better than 10 centimeters per pixel. Yeah, and sorry, in terms of constraint, because it's a 6U CubeSat, we are limited by telecommunication, but we can reach targets that are within 1 AU from Earth at the time of encounter. So that's relatively good. So yeah, just some details. So I was talking about leveraging recent investments in a small subsystems and in solar cells. So this is just summarizing basically what our flight system is made up of. It will use some of the subsystems that will be validated in space by the Inspire CubeSat. It will use a camera from Mailin that is with a lot of heritage, so that's an important point of the mission. Agile science algorithms, processing algorithms that are going to be validated on the IPEX mission, and as well as so all the solar cell work that has been developed by Marshall. I forgot to ask, I'm sorry, that the co-PI of this mission is Les Johnson, who is the lead technologist for solar cell at Marshall. So just to give you an idea of scale, ENISCAT will be the smallest and the biggest mission that has ever flown. So 62 CubeSat, that's a human guy, so I'm shorter actually. That's the Soyuz and that's the sail scale. It's about 80 square meter sail. So our early career engineers like to say that it's bigger than their apartment. So I was supposed to show a movie. I was not cleared for the movie, but I will leave it in the presentation and it should be available next week. Now I'm going to talk about the target. So we started from the NRAT target, of course, which is very well done. And so all, you know, we took what we could find, and basically we found targets that are very close to those targets considered for human exploration. So basically low orbit condition code, you know, if possible greater than 10 meters and a synodic period less than 10 years. And when you look, I mean, there are a lot of targets in the HENHAT database, but basically what is accessible to us is this pool of targets at about 1 AU from an orbit of about 1 AU in semi-major axis and a very small eccentricity. And that's what we're targeting. And here is a result of the search that Eamon Lando has been carrying out for us. So this is a complete chart. I'm going to walk you through that chart. It shows, as a function of the launch year, it shows you the flight time for a bunch of targets that are available, and they are sorted out in terms of the distance for telecom at the time of encounter, so less than 0.25 AU and up to 1 AU. The orbit condition code that gives you an idea of whether it's an easy target that would be easy to find or a hard target that would be difficult to localize, and really want to work with targets that have an OCC that is less than 2. And then the size, which is less of a driver, like basically we take whatever is available, and small, medium, and large. So our nominal launch date is December 2017 with the SLS, with EM1. And what we found, so if I do that, oops. So there was some animation that got lost. No, okay. Oh yeah, okay. So here you see our main target is 1991 VG. That can be reached about 2 years after launch. And 1991 VG has a 1 sigma position uncertainty of 2,700 kilometers, which is not too bad. And it's about 10 meters in diameter. So it's a very small target. And we have a backup, which is 2013 BS45. Why now? The reason why we keep it as a backup is that it takes longer to get there. We want to get to our target as soon as possible. The other thing is that the telecom distance at the time of encounter is close to 1 AU, which is challenging. So we are going with the easier target. So what do we know about 1991 VG? So some people think it's an alien probe. Other people think it's a stage from the Saturn V, but Paul is pretty sure that it's a real object. But we don't know much about that target. Its magnitude is high, 28.4, diameter between 4 and 17 meters. Albedo is unknown, although it's been showing very strong variations in albedo, which is one of the reasons it's been compared to a man-made, a rocket fragment. Rotation period maybe between a few minutes, maybe 1 hour, maybe more. We don't know. It's unlikely to have a companion. An object of that size is unlikely to retain a companion or a dust cloud. At least it's what we think. Although after the Spitzer observations a few weeks ago of 2011 and D, it's been suggested that maybe asteroids may be cores with, traveling with their own cloud disagree. So, but we need to get there to figure out, right? We need in situ ground truth observations to really answer that type of question. Okay, so a little bit on the science definition. Here is the list of the strategic knowledge gaps that are relevant to asteroids. It's a very nice chart that was put together by Polyball and updated with information relevant to any scout. So we have the location, the size, rotation rate, particle environment, and debris field. Some idea of the really mechanical and geotechnical properties, the mass density, the surface morphology and mineralogy and chemical composition. We can touch on all of these to some extent with any scout, with imaging. So for location, we will, because we will meet the target, its OECC will be decreased to zero. We will be able to get the size and detect satellites with a very good accuracy. We have 10 centimeters per pixel at closest approach. We will be able to pinpoint the pole and the rotation velocity. We think that that part is easy. Whether or not we can have a good assessment of the local environment is a function of how long we can spend at the target, whether we are in a flyby or rendezvous mode, and this is still under assessment. How much we can learn about regolith mechanical properties of the object is also a function of how well we can image, under various illumination angles, and that's also under assessment. In terms of determining the mass, it will be an indirect determination from, the volume and information obtained, constraints on the mineralogy based on taxonomy. So it's really indirect. And we would be able to get some good resolution on morphology, especially if we stay long enough. And we will have the capability to at least get the taxonomy of the target. So that's just a chart summarizing what we'll be able to see in Bolt. I don't know if it looks so well. But the message here is that we are going to learn of information that is of importance to exploration, but also of importance to science. Planetary defense and resource utilization to some extent. So there is with imaging, we have a very nice synergistic observations for these four areas of interest to NASA. So, going to the a little bit more science definition, we will be able to, we will stay long enough to image the targets over one rotation, provided that its rotation period is less than 10 minutes. Which is likely based on statistics. And we will do limb fitting as well as some stereophotochronometry. This will help get also the rotation properties. And we have a science grade camera, and we have a very nice plan for calibration, so we'll be able to get albedo as well. This drives requirements on coverage, flyby velocity, and photometry accuracy. So we are taking that into account. We will also obtain some morphological mapping of the surface. It's not clear for how much of the surface, but we will have some information using photoclinometry. And this will drive illumination requirements. It's information that we pass to the engineering team. And here I'm showing what we will do in terms of spectral type determination. We will have four color filters on the camera, four bands that will help put data points to be compared against spectra available for number of classes of asteroids, and also to be compared against meteorites. So we should be able to differentiate between having an S-type asteroid or having a C-type asteroid, and that drives stability. Doing color drives stability requirements. And we'll be able to observe the local environment because we have a very large field of view. So we will do backscatter imaging. So it will be very interesting to see exactly what's going on at the target in terms of having a dust cloud and having debris. So to finish, a little bit of information on the science implementation. So we'll fly the Mei-Li NICAM M50, we like it very much because it's high TRL, but also because of OSIRIS-REx is also using a similar model for its mission. So we know that it will have a high heritage after flying. We've been working a lot with the sensor and trying to understand the signal to noise waveforms. And we are in good shape in terms of detecting the target. Something that the camera doesn't have yet, but we are working on, is adding color filters at the top of the frame in order to do color without adding a dedicated instrument. And that's going to be very interesting too. I mean, Justin Boland, who is working on the camera, I thought had a very novel idea to apply these filters on top. Yeah, I'm mostly done. So, okay, let me pass because it has an animation. I'm just going, in terms of concept of operation, I'm just going to focus on the close proximity phase. We will arrive at about 20 kilometers from closest approach. The target is bigger than 2 pixels in the frame. So this is where we start the acquisition of images that will address all the level one requirements, besides the ephemeris. And we have a flyby velocity of about 10 to 20 meters per second. And what this means is that we spend between 40 and 20 minutes at the target. So how much coverage we get is a function of the rotation period, basically. Hopefully that it's rotating fast. And so in terms of lightning, we arrive under, so sorry, this chart shows the illumination angle, if you want, as a function of the distance to the target. And on the way in, inbound, we'll have very nice illumination below 20 degrees. Past closest approach, we will have very nice imaging conditions for backscatter imaging of the environment. And at 1 kilometer to the target, we will have a resolution of 10 centimeters per pixel. So just to summarize the observation plan, we will get the ephemeris from observation and the unresolved target starting about 10,000 kilometers away. We during that period, before we get to the target, we will get the photometry and the color observations that will tell us about the taxonomy. And at closest approach, we'll perform reconnaissance and get the volume, the shape, the spin rate, and pole position with imaging at 50 centimeters per pixel. And at closest approach, we hope to see regolith for at least 30% of the surface. And to finish, I wanted to say that this mission is a good opportunity to infuse software, agile science software, that allows increasing the science return in constrained resources. So it's something that we are developing a lot. I'm just involved in that type of stuff. Basically, the idea is to, because our silicon rate will be less than 500 BPS, we will have to do a lot of data triage compression, you know, thumbnails, sorting of the images and retrieval of the key images for science. And this is where the science team is going to play a very important role. That's it. Thank you.
Great. We have time for questions. Do we have any questions in the audience? No? Okay, I see one over there. Who, get a microphone. Please state your name before you ask your question.
Hi, Eric Goldstrom. I was wondering, how long after the encounter do you expect to keep transmitting data back at this low rate?
So right now, we need 1 month to retrieve the images that we are required for meeting the level one requirements. We could transmit as long as DSN is available for us. It's clear that we would have to compete for DSN time, but there is no limitation for transmitting from the spacecraft standpoint.
Any other questions? Oh, here's one. Ben Bussey.
That's who I am. So just curious, you said that you can get 10 centimeters at closest approach, but your velocity is at 10 kilometers a second?
No, it's between 10 and 20 meters.
So you could do it without getting smear?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's not a problem. Attitude control is going to follow.
Okay. You mean you can integrate enough time?
I mean, we integrate, we don't do color, so with our just our regular monochromatic sensor, we have integration times of about 10, 20 milliseconds.
Okay.
Okay, well, thank you very much.